Wellness Waves, a podcast by Fortis Healthcare to discuss health and wellness-related topics with nationally renowned experts from Fortis. Join us on this enlightening journey and ride the waves of wellness.
Thank you all for joining us today for this special session on parenting for all the working parents. We are thrilled to bring together Dr. Neetu Talwar, who is the Additional Director, Division of Pediatric Pulmonology, Fortis Hospital, Gurgaon. She's a graduate and postgraduate from SETH GS Medical College and KEM Hospital, Mumbai. She has completed her fellowship in Pediatric Pulmonology from Sir Ganga Naram Hospital, Delhi. She has also trained in Pediatric Pulmonology from Birmingham Children's Hospital, UK. Dr. Neetu is an EB member of Indian Academy of Pediatric National Respiratory Chapter. She has also been the secretary and the finance secretary for Pediatric Respiratory Society in Delhi. She has made immense academic contributions and has written several chapters in books and articles in journals. She will guide us through some of the essential aspects of child health and well-being today. Today, we explore practical insights on everything from respiratory health to being resilient, and we hope that this session will offer you tools and encouragement to support your children's growth and wellness. So thank you once again for joining in today. We're looking for a meaningful and enriching discussion. Welcome, Doctor.
Thank you so much, Sailaja, for the wonderful introduction. And I'm very thankful to the organizing team for organizing this podcast on this very, very important topic on parenting. And we will also be covering a little bit about respiratory health in children. So I think we'll start.
Yes. First question that I would like to ask you is, what are the some common illnesses that children experience today and how can the working parents prevent from them?
In the past 15 days, 1 month, we are having lot of viral illnesses, flu virus and other viral infections. We are having lot of dengues coming in. What is specific about dengue in this season is it's a bad variant. We are having both ICU admissions. We have had patients going on ventilators and so on and so forth. We have lot of typhoids coming in. On overall, it's a bad season for children. So, you know, a few tips on how to manage, because all of us who are working at our workplaces, you know, we are scared that are our children safe and is there anything to worry about. So whenever you get a call from the caregiver or the school or the child calls you that I'm not well, the first thing that you must do is to do a video call. Have a look at the child. Okay, it may be that there's an emergency. So just saying crocin de do and cough syrup de do won't help. So be sure yourself, don't delegate it to somebody else. Look at your child, look at the color, look at the activity, look whether he's lethargic, look at whether he's able to talk or no. If all that is in place, yes, you all know crocin and brufen and fluids and rest and all those should suffice. Now, another tip is if the fever comes with cold and cough, most likely it's a viral illness. You don't have to rush to the doctor, at least for the first 3 to 4 days. You could just let the child rest, be around with him. You may be there on the phone, on the video call, and just see to it he's hydrated well and he's eating little bit frequently. Because none of us would be starting antibiotics, none of us would be asking for investigations if there is a cold and cough along with fever. On the other hand, if it's just fever alone, it could be anything from dengue to typhoid. Even then, in case your child is stable, there is no need to rush and consult the doctor in case he's stable. What my advice is 50% of activity and 50% of oral intake. If that is in place, then there is no need to worry. Now, the last tip is when to rush to the doctor. If there is high-grade fever, if there is lethargy, like I said, 50% and less of intake, 50% and less of activity. If there are rashes, if the child is irritable or he's very lethargic, not having good oral intake, urination is less than once in 6 hours, then you must not wait for this 2 or 3 or 4 days. You must go immediately. don't delay the consultation.
Thank you. I think it was quite an insightful answer. And I would say that we feel blessed these days that we as parents have the facility of doing a video call to children.
Yes, absolutely.
Imagine what our parents must have going through when this was the condition at that time. What nutritional advice do you have for busy working parents to ensure that their children maintain a healthy, balanced diet?
Yeah, so having a good nutrition ensures that half the battle is won, because your child is going to be healthy, your child is not going to be on those fast foods and junk foods and not keep falling ill every other day. So if you're working, of course there would be somebody looking after the major meals. So what is balanced nutrition? It is, you know, major nutrients, minor nutrients in a select proportion. Only protein and, you know, you're binging on that, that is, everything in excess is harmful. So we have to have a balance. Then the next thing is that they should be hydrated properly. None of us are really having enough of fluid intake. So we should, you know, tell them that you have to have a good oral intake. It could be milk, it could be water, but they should keep having sips of water. You could give them a bottle and then say, by the time I come back, it should be over. And other things that you could leave in the refrigerator is, you know, they would feel hungry. I mean, they're children after all. You could have salads, you could have sprouts salads, then you could have chana salad, fruits. And you should walk the talk. I mean, you can't be ordering pizzas and, oh, I don't feel like eating that dal chawal, I want to have pizza, and expect that they will be, you know, following your advice. So you have homemade, freshly cooked food, regular meal times, no compromises on holidays and Sundays. Stick to a routine. A correct discipline will ensure that your child will ultimately do very well. So it starts with diet.
As hoteliers, it looks very difficult for us to do that, but definitely your advice, we will try and follow, Doc. Thank you. How can working parents effectively manage their children's health and wellness while balancing their professional responsibilities? I think this is a very, very important question that everybody is looking forward to.
Yeah, this is, you know, it's a very personal question for me also, because, you know, all this time, even I go around with a guilt that, you know, my poor children, if they were born to a lady who was not working and was not busy, possibly it would have been better and all those things. So at the end of this, you know, I would like to, you know, I just read it before the podcast. I would like to quote Mr. Ratan Tata, who is being really missed by everybody, because he was I don't know how to put it, for all of us. And he's written that, you know, an iron can't harm itself, the rust will. So, you know, nobody can harm you. It's your own mental health and your own mind is which is going to harm you. So have a balance. So the first answer is, don't get stressed. If you want to have a good family life and you have to have that perfect balance of work and family, see to it that your mental balance and your mental health is perfect. For that, you have to have this maybe 10 minutes of meditation. This is not, you know, big talk or smart talk. It actually helps. You could just get up and just close your eyes and just be with yourself for 10 minutes. It could be at your workspace. You could do some breathing exercises. Again, this could be at your workspace. You could do yoga. You could be just fit and healthy and be happy. Only if you are happy, you are going to spread happiness. Otherwise, all that stress will come out on your family, your children, and then even if you end up becoming a big achiever, that itself might go against you in case your children are not doing well. I mean, you are an international figure, you are a national figure, and your children are not doing well, their grades are not good. So that itself will, you know, go against you. That is what I feel. So always introspect, tell yourself, yes, I want a balance. Because in case you are that all in, all out ambitious type, then don't have children. They shouldn't suffer because you didn't have time for them and you didn't plan them. It's as simple as that. This is not a favor that you're doing. It's a responsibility. It's a duty. You have to do it. So first of all, your own mental health, your exercise, your routines, your happiness, and then having quality time for your children, where that quality time is child-centric. It shouldn't be that I'm trying to do some work and I'm trying to get his homework done and I'm utilizing that time. If that half an hour, 1 hour exclusively is being given to the children, just spend it with the child. Do what he likes. He may just like to scribble. He may just want to talk. He may just want to go out for a walk with you. So just see to it that you're doing all these things. And at the end of the day, tell him a story. Our culture is so rich. There are so many stories and they have a good meaning. They have a good moral at the end of it. Invest that time in building up a good foundation.
We should definitely utilize our off days.
Yeah, absolutely.
It is very important to pamper yourself and also to take care of kids. So I'm sure we'll manage that in a better way. Children can feel stressed due to academic and social pressures. How can working parents support their emotional well-being while managing their work own stress?
Yeah, this is, I think, the most important question in today's times, and that is stress. So I've often heard the sentence, "Oh, doc, I'm working so hard, I'm so stressed," and then I go back and my child is just answering back, not listening to me and things like that. So what I want to say is that recognize that a child can also have his or her portion of stress. For a toddler, it could be just that you're not buying the toy and they would just lie down on the floor in front of the shop and cry, and you know, everybody would say, "Arre, le do, bichare ko," you know. For an older child, it could be just a sibling rivalry, it could be something from the peer group, from the teachers. And there are a group of children who don't want to confide with the parents because they feel that the parents are working very hard. So look out for soft signals. If the child is not sleeping well, if he's gaining too much weight, losing excess weight, if he's, you know, a little withdrawn, if he's aggressive, irritable, it could be something. It's not that he's disobeying you. It could be that there is some problem. Talk to your child. And from the very beginning, have this time with your child. Don't delegate it to anybody else. Talk to him. How was your day? Who are your friends? You should know the names of his friends. You should know the name of his teachers. So please, and yes, one important thing that I want to say in that balance thing is we are living in a very technologically advanced world, the world of AI. Have calendars. You get the school calendar at the beginning of the session. Please write down the PTMs, because the PTM dates and the school important functions of the schools and the sports day, please write it down. It's very easy to manage your calendar. Be prepared for it. And always at workplace, you must learn to say no. That, sorry, I can't take up this work because I will not be able to do justice. And in case you have a setback because of it, don't feel bad. It's the best investment that you're doing. So I think that's the way we should handle our children. They are like a seed, you know. If a gardener looks after a plant, then definitely that plant will bloom and will grow up very well. Our children are absolute innocent seeds which we get. Nurture them with love. They have to confide everything in you. Then there is no stress. They will come up with each and every little problem. That is a relationship you have to have. And then you set them free. And they will be safe. They will not do anything wrong. They will live up to whatever goals you've set for them. Just have a good foundation. That's what I want to stress.
These are small memories that we create with our children. And I think when they grow up, we will remember that.
Yeah.
So definitely please balance your time. And then professional relationship is of course important. We are all working hard because we also have our aims, career goals in life. But this is also important, which we can't neglect. Right? Doc, what are your recommendations for establishing a healthy sleep habits in children? Yeah. And why is it crucial for their development?
Yeah. So as a pulmonologist, I have, because you know, initially it used to be that snoring is good, it's deep sleep, and you know, I used to I've never slept for more than 3 hours or 4 hours in my entire life. Initially it used to be for studying, and then it was work, and then you know, you want to excel. I mean, there is something in you that you have to do it, you have to be the best. But then you know, I realized, now I think I'm going to give a personal example. I ended up with a BP of 100-120 on a random check. I couldn't believe it. I said, 120 pe to hemorrhage ho jata hai, and how come I'm not having any problem? And that was my wake up call. And I started sleeping. And I've never been on medication. So my sincere request to all the adults also is, please sleep. At our age, we require 7 to 9 hours of uninterrupted sleep. Similarly, for children at various ages, different hours of sleep is required. So nothing, not even exams, nothing should compromise your sleep, because when you're sleeping, you're rejuvenating yourself, you're healing yourself, your concentration, memory is improving, all the clutter is getting cleansed. This has been proven. Your cerebrospinal fluid is working better, you're becoming a healthier person, and you're going to live longer. So sleep is very important. And my standard questions are, is your child snoring? Is your child opening his mouth while sleeping? Does he have nightmares? Does he have bedwetting? Does he have a restlessness? So if any of these is present, please consult your doctor. It could be something as simple as an adenoid, and it is totally treatable. So you have to have a good sleep, uninterrupted.
Thank you. We'll move on?
Yeah.
Okay. In this digital age, what strategies do you recommend for managing screen time to promote both mental and physical health in children?
Again, you know, this all starts from the very beginning. You can't wake up at when your child is 13 years of age and say, no, you're watching too much of TV, you're too much on the gadgets. So from the very beginning, you are not going to be gifting, after they are into professional courses, that's another issue. But till they are in school and till 12th, don't gift them their personal phones or their iPads or something like that. All these electronic devices should be shared. I mean, they can use the parents' devices. So if you go into the theory aspect of it, the American College of Adolescent and Child Psychology recommends that till the age of 1.5 years, only a video call to parents or family is permitted. That's all. Then maybe for the next till 2.5 years, it's only maybe you're showing them some nursery rhymes or something like that. After that, the schools nowadays, you know, they require a lot of screen time. They involve a lot of screen time. So apart from the school work, it could be just 1 hour in a day and a maximum of 3 hours in the weekends. That's it. So you have to call the shots, and you have to put parental locks, and you have to set your limits. And like I said, it can't be that you're sitting and watching your favorite soap on the phone while sleeping and expect that your child doesn't do the same. Now, what are the hazards? Lack of concentration, bad grades, then, you know, and they're missing out on that interpersonal relationship. I mean, when they're sitting with those devices, they would rather be outside, they would play, they would gain so much but from interacting. And in today's world, and even in previous things, it's all about interactions. If you have a good, meaningful interaction, you learn, you cultivate relationships, and you do well. So in case they are missing out on those things, so it's really sad. So you know about this, and don't give their gadgets to them. And of course, then, you know, they are watching all sorts of things. You have no control. And the most harmful things are those ads which are targeted at these children. Energy drink. My own child, I will not name the company, but yeah, this is an energy drink. I want to order it. So all these are full of caffeine. They are having preservatives. They are harmful. So we shouldn't, this is I think a very, very important issue which all of us should tackle, because it's so easy. Let me finish my work. You take the phone and you, so don't do that.
What all activities do you recommend, Doc, that we should involve kids into so that they are away from the mobiles and laptops?
Yeah, so outdoor activities, and you have to see what the child enjoys most, so that we are not forcing. I want my child to be an ace cricketer, but the child doesn't like cricket. So don't force your dreams and your hobbies. It may be that he doesn't like what you would have loved. So building up upon that, encourage him to, you know, music. You could use the YouTube so that he can learn guitar, he could learn singing, he could learn dancing. That way, positively, you could use the devices. And then outdoor activities, sports. You yourself could, you know, involve them maybe into cooking, something like cooking, making something and helping you, so that, you know, your load also is a little off.
We'll try and follow that too. Thank you. And for the audience who's joined online, I would request if you have any questions, you can post it on the chat box and we'll take it later at the end of the session. Now, with regards to the respiratory infections, now with both working parents, how can they prevent and manage common respiratory infections in children and especially those who are attending the daycare at the school?
So, first of all, if your child is unwell, if he's having fever, see, cold and cough without fever is an allergy. That child can go to school. If that cold and cough is coming with fever, then it's a viral infection. So you should tell the teacher, don't tell my child not to come. He's allergic. He's having an allergic cough. Otherwise, those poor children, they end up sitting at home all the time and getting that negative this also, that I'm not up to mark as the other children. So if your child is having fever and cold and cough, don't send him to school, first of all, so that others don't carry it. Then whenever the season of flu infections is there, you could tell him to wear a mask. Vaccinate at the appropriate time. Flu vaccinations are available, pneumonia vaccinations are available. Just mark it on your calendar and go for the vaccination in that time period. Then secondly, at home, you know, I always tell my patients that let the home breathe. We are so possessed with the outdoor pollution that we are locking ourselves up and everything is closed so that the polluted air outside doesn't enter. But what about the indoor pollutants? Nobody's talking about it. The indoor pollutants keep circulating. So you have to open up the doors and the windows from maybe 7 in the morning till maybe 2 in the afternoon. Let the house breathe. Let the house feel fresh. So that's the most important thing, clean air. Okay. Then secondly, the hand hygiene. You should always tell them to keep washing their hands, especially before eating anything. And then cough hygiene, cough etiquettes. Now COVID has made us wiser. We all know that we cannot just go on coughing just like that. We would cover our mouth and, you know, we could just flex our elbows and cough into that. So these simple things, not to touch surfaces. These simple things should be, you know, taught to the child so that he can take care. Ultimately, we have to make the child self-sufficient. He has to take care of himself. So teach them the normal good things.
Now, moving on, what are the recurring cold and cough is on the rise these days?
Yeah.
And what tips do you have for working parents to manage this?
Okay, so recurring, this is just jokingly I'm saying that many children would maybe have just 3 or 4 episodes in a year, and the mother would say, "Arey, jab dekho khansi karta rehta." So, you know, very objectively, you have to write down. Maybe the episode doesn't require that you go to the doctor, but in case your child is having at least one episode in a month or 6 weeks, then yes, that is recurrent cold and cough. Because 7 to 8 episodes in a year is okay. All children will have that. You can't have any control over that. So in case it is recurrent, especially if it comes with a cough, which is, early morning or worsens in the night during sleep time, then if there are nasal discharges, then yes, that could be an allergic cough. For allergy, we have to make changes in the home, which is anyway going to be good for the family also. Try to have you can't have a zero chemical home, but have a minimum amount of chemical in the house. So, you know, perfumes and deos, they should be not used at home. At workplace, you could use it and use some cubicle to store it, so that by the time you go back, the chemicals are not going to be carried back. Second most important thing is smoking. Please don't feel that you've smoked and you've then entered the house and it's not going to damage. That smoke is going to be there in your exhaled breath for many hours after you have smoked. Then the third thing is, all these wet surfaces which will have fungus on them, especially in the bathrooms. So you have to be very careful. Carpets and wall carpets will gather a lot of allergens. So try not to have it at home. Agarbattis, one could give up and use diyas. Then good nights, all these anti-mosquito things, don't use that, use the electric racket. And that is how we should be controlling. Other important thing is the kitchen smells. When the food is being cooked, it will smell very nice, but the AQI of the house can go up to 1000. So when the food is being cooked, have the exhaust on, have the child play outdoors or be locked up in his room so that he's not exposed in case he's having recurrent colds and coughs. Otherwise, there is no problem. And last thing is about the car hygiene. In case your child is having recurrent colds and coughs, do see to it that your car is cleaned more often. Don't use car perfumes and keep your car clean. Many times we forget about that.
Okay, any immunity builder that you advise for children that we can give and would help in building immunity?
Actually, you know, this is the question which every mother asks. So there is nothing called as, you know, that I need to boost up my immunity, because we are all born with a very good robust system in place. And we just have to see to it that the child is sleeping well, eating home cooked food, having good habits, good exercise schedule, and then nothing is required. I wouldn't really recommend any oral supplements. Just give a good balanced diet, a good food, and in case he's allergic, treat him, because your kadas and your homeopathies are not the answer in case your child is having repeated colds and coughs. Take treatment. Give him the inhalers which the doctor is advising. There is no shortcut to that.
Nice. I think this is a really, really insightful session till now, and we've learned a lot. Moving on, this is related to exercise and lung health. Now, how important is it for a regular physical activity in supporting children's lung health, and what activities do you recommend?
You know, in case I say that something has to be done, it may or may not go well with the child. But if I do it in a play-like manner, then definitely they would follow it. So exercise and sports activities are a very good method of building up good lung health. So for all my asthmatics, once they are in good control, I always say go out and see to it that they are having vigorous exercise. Not like carom board or you know, maybe table tennis, no. One would recommend swimming, basketball, I mean vigorous exercise in which he's running and really doing activity and not just sitting in one corner and you know. So swimming, I think, is a very all-round good exercise for the lungs, for the whole body, and I would definitely recommend it. There was another part of this question, I'm forgetting, which exercise and
what activities do you recommend?
Okay, so this is what I would say, that you put him dancing, singing, so that they enjoy doing these things. And many of the top class swimmers and athletes have had issues when they were children. Beckham, yeah, that movie Bend It with Beckham. Beckham was an asthmatic, and then he's gone on to become a great football player. So there are so many examples in which the child has had a problem and exercises are advised, and they took it as a challenge and then made success stories out of it and professions out of it. So we must encourage outdoor activities.
We should not ignore anything that we experience with the children. It is very important to take care of them. While it is difficult to manage work and home together, but I'm sure the ladies will do it, and gentlemen should also do. It was about, can you explain the risk of secondhand smoke exposure in children, and how can parents ensure that their children are protected from this risk?
So the latter part I would like to answer first. Quit smoking today, ASAP. You're harming yourself, you're harming your children. And the difference between harming yourself and your children is that their lungs are immature, they're developing, and they have their entire life ahead of them. Wo to smoke bhi nahi kar rahe hain, and they are getting the effects of it. So please, for your children's sake, quit smoking. And rest assured that, you know, like I said, smoking in the balcony, many patients will say, I brush my teeth after I have a smoke, so, you know, nobody can smell it. So all that is, you know, just, I don't want to elaborate on that, but please, it will remain in your breath for many, many hours, and it will continue to harm your entire family. So you have more chances of allergies, you have more chances of sinusitis, you have more chances of infections, of flu, then of asthma, the obesity, cancers, hypertension, all these things happen in children also. So all those things will be a fallout. And there is something called as a third hand smoke also. Third hand smoke is, I've smoked and then that nicotine particles and the other chemicals are suspended in the air. They settle down on the carpet, on the surface and all that. And for months, the child is exposed. So we are talking about something which is very, very dangerous. And I wish that you understand the gravity of the situation. Nothing is more important than your child's health. So for their sake, you can have chewing gum. There are 100 ways of giving it up. You know, you just have to decide. You don't require training sessions and counseling sessions to give up. You just have to decide, I will not do it. That's it. It's as simple as that.
Very true, Doc. On the box of the cigarette only, it's the picture states and that it, what will happen to you. But
and
still,
it's very finely written that it's injurious. But every hero of a Bollywood movie would be, you know, smoking. And you know, look at the message that they're giving to the children. It's so cool to smoke and it's stylish to smoke. So that is where we are not, you know, practicing what we are teaching. They should not be allowed to show that.
So to all the fathers and the mothers who smoke,
yeah, please,
this is a humble request to all of you, yes, that please, please, please curtail. This is not good for your children and for the family too.
Many of us are living in joint families. We have our parents, yes, they have brought us up with love, care, and we are doing so well because of them. So for their health, for the sake of our pregnant wives, you know, in utero exposure to smoke, and the child will be born with a lesser volume of brain, with the low birth weights, you may have stillborns, abortion, I mean the list is endless. So I want to scare you properly so that everybody seriously quits smoking after today's session.
I wish to. What are the signs that a child's breathing difficulty might be serious, or when should parents seek medical attention for it?
Okay, so when, you know, we come across, maybe I'll take that after the first part. Okay, when your child is having, retractions is like that, you know, the muscles are seen, or if something like wheezing is something like this. So while I'm exhaling, this noise is coming. This is called as wheezing, because sometimes even a nose block will be misunderstood as wheezing, and we get calls, or if the child is wheezing and it's only a nose block. So recognize the sound which I just made, that is wheezing. So if that sound is there, if he's using his muscles to breathe, if he's having head bobbing, in small children, head bobbing, that is a very, very dangerous sign. Look at the color of the tips of his toes and his fingertips. If that is turning dusky, that is a very, very dangerous sign. If he's, you know, not able to speak in sentences, Mama, I'm not well, that is a very, very dangerous sign. He's not able to speak. If he's not able to lie down, that is a red flag. You have to rush to the hospital. He's not able to lie down. He has to sit up so that gravity increases the volume of his lungs, and only then he can breathe. So as a contrary, if your child is in such a situation, make him sit up so that, you know, his oxygenation improves. So that is a red flag where you have to just rush to the hospital. And one important thing I would like to say is there is something called a psychogenic cough. You know, with all the working parents that we have, sometimes for attention seeking, children might come up with symptoms. So that is the reason. If he's breathing like this or like this, many parents will come, oh, this breathing doesn't stop. He will just take a deep sigh and it goes on and on and on. So this is a psychogenic cough. So again, you are not going to say you are bluffing it. You just have to understand that there is some stress. He wants your time, give it to him. And this psychogenic cough, whenever he's watching the TV, there will never be any cough. When he's sleeping, there will never be any cough. So a problem will crop up in the middle of the night also, whether he's watching TV or having pasta, it will have. So be on the watch out, because you know, all of you are working and you're doing well. So children are very, very smart and they might just fool you. So beware.
So we all have born actors at home. I'm sure we all are experiencing that.
Yeah.
They're very, very smart. Doc, how has COVID-19 impacted children's lung health? And what should parents watch out in the long run? Especially if their child has had COVID-19.
Okay. So, you know, I think we were, this generation has experienced the great pandemic. Otherwise, even, you know, we used to get questions. What should be done when there is a pandemic? And we would just learn it from the, mug it up from the book and write it. And when the pandemic came, we actually didn't know how to handle it because we had not experienced it. So COVID luckily has not affected many children, and there were hardly any mortalities because of COVID. Asthmatic children were very well controlled because nobody was going out, the traffic was at the minimum, pollution was low. So it was amazing for children, I must say. But nevertheless, we don't have data. We don't know whether they were affected because carriers, we were not detecting the carriers. We were not doing it as a routine test. So it may have affected the lungs. To what extent, what it did, we do not know. But there have been reports where chronic lung diseases, restrictive lung diseases, then cystic lung diseases, all these are possible and they can be detected only on CT scan, which is really not advised as a routine checkup. You can't do CT scans and expose the children to radiation. In case you feel that the lung health needs to be checked, you could go ahead with the pulmonary function test, the spirometry. Below 6 years, you could go in for forced oscillometry technique. It's just a breathing technique and you come to know about the lung health. It wouldn't be a bad idea to incorporate this test as part of your good health checkup. So that is one thing we can do.
Okay, great. So I would have the last one from my side and then we will take questions from the audience.
Yeah, absolutely.
Now, emergency preparedness. Okay. Very important. Now, what should parents have ready at home or in the first aid kit for the respiratory emergencies like asthma attacks?
So, if you're prepared for a war, I mean, then the war won't happen because then, you know, the other person would be afraid of attacking you. So, in that same breath, I would like to say, if you're prepared for an emergency, if you're aware what to look for, the red flags, then there really wouldn't be an emergency because you'd be taking the precautions well in time. So what, in case your child is having asthma or allergic cough or bronchitis, I mean, many people don't like the word asthma, so name it, whatever you want, you could name it, but the treatment remains the same. So in case that is there, you must first of all visit your doctor and have this treatment plan ready. You could mail it to you or WhatsApp it to yourself so that in an emergency, one tends to forget everything. It's an utter chaos. The child is not breathing. The child is just, you know, becoming lethargic and you just don't know what to do. So mail it so that, and label it emergency medicine for asthma, and you can open it and, you know, you can see the steps, what needs to be done. So first of all, keep your inhalers in place, Levulin or Astilin, salbutamol or levosalbutamol. This is an emergency medicine. Please keep it and keep extra inhalers at home. Many times you go and maybe after 6 months you're using it and it's over and then it's a total mess because there is no medicine. So keep extra inhalers at home. Spacers is what we recommend with the inhalers. Keep the spacers in a place where you would remember where it is placed. Otherwise you put it in such a safe place that you forget where I've kept it. So have extra spacers in the school bag. Emergencies can happen anywhere, anytime. They can happen at school, they can happen in the school bus, they can happen at home. So the inhaler, the spacer has to be there in the school cupboard, it has to be there in the school bag, it has to be there at home. Have three sets. And steroids usually are magical drugs. They will just reverse a flare-up, but we don't recommend patient-initiated steroid because in case that fails, then for the doctor there's nothing except ventilating. So we don't want the patient to come at that point. So in case this is not working, whenever the child is unwell, you give Levulin inhaler back to back. You could give 4 to 10 puffs one after the other. Then wait for 20 minutes, give another 4 to 10 puffs, wait for 20 minutes, give another 4 to 10 puffs. So in 1 hour, you have had these, wait and see the response. In case he is better, you stay at home and give it 3 hourly. If not, then you give it and come to the hospital. In the car, you keep giving it and come to the hospital. So only these two things are required in an emergency, and this could be life-saving. I mean, in case you have listened to the last 2 minutes of what I've spoken, it could save an admission, it could save an ICU admission, it could save a life, especially in adolescents. Adolescents want to hide their, they want to appear very cool, they want to hide their problem, and they will quietly keep taking the medicine, not telling it to the parent, and then, you know, you end up in a problem. So keep consulting your doctor. Nowadays teleconsults are there, so many facilities are there. Have an action plan ready, and what I told you, 4 to 10 puffs every 20 minutes 3 times, and this can be done only once. It's not that 2 din ke baad wapas ho raha hai and then again you keep doing this. Many patients will say, doctor, whatever you said we did, then 1 hourly we have done, we have started steroids, now what? Now what? Now you have to end up in the ICU. So there is a limit to which everything can be treated at home. Recognize that limit, come in time, so that the child recovers, because we are talking about the airways and the oxygenation. Oxygenation to the whole body, the brain, the heart, the lungs, the liver, the kidney, because they would be compromised, and then the actual thing reverses and the end organ troubles start. The kidney is damaged and the creatinine goes up and the sensorium, this thing. Again, I am scaring you so that you follow what I have said and take consultation at the proper time.
Look, adding on to it, any other medicines that you want to tell us so that we can keep it in the medical box at home?
Yeah. So, one common basic question, many of you would laugh, kya re, fever ke bare mein Dr. Neetu wants to speak. I want to talk about fever. So, whenever your child has fever, please give paracetamol, because it's the safest medicine. Okay. Dose, you could calculate. It's 10 to 15 milligram per kg per dose. So, calculate the dose and give it to your child. Now, if the fever doesn't come down in half an hour, give Brufen. Brufen is 10 milligram per kg per dose. Okay. And then simultaneously, you give sponging with tap water. If the tap water is very cold, you add water so that it's comfortably cold and warm, as tested on the upper surface of your wrist. Now, if the fever repeats after 4 hours, you could give Crocin. If it repeats within 4 hours, then you could give Brufen, like I told you. If it's very high fever, give everything. Fever management is the most important thing nowadays, because dengues are going around. And the other thing I want to talk, Crocin and Brufen would take care of the headache, the earaches also. Now, loose motions, I mean, these are again very, very common problems. So it's the diet which is most important. Just cut down on the sweet intake for 2 days. Don't give him aerated drinks, don't give him cold drinks, don't give him anything sweet. Just give rice, that will give him energy, that's carbohydrates. Give rice, dal, give yogurt or curd, coconut water, banana. These 5 things, and you may not require any medicine. Apart from this, you could keep probiotics at home. What I usually recommend is Enterogermina. You get small ampules, you use it twice a day, and a maximum of maybe antacid like Lanzol Junior. So apart from this, you don't require anything for gastroenteritis. MCET, we could give that for vomiting. So your colds and coughs are sorted. For a mild cold and cough, maybe Maxtra or something like that. Any usual cough syrup should be good enough. And for the nose, except for saline drops, nothing else. Don't use medicated nasal drops, because they would ultimately harm the mucosa. Then you'll have nasal bleeds, and many children have nasal bleeds. So don't use local medicines for the nose. So I think if any specific treatment you want, you could ask.
I think this is
what is sufficient. Commonly required at home.
Correct. Thank you, Doc. I'll just ask the audience who's right in front of us is if anybody has any questions to ask.
Yes. Again, yeah. So I'm sorry about whenever I was speaking about bad quality sleep. I mean, good quality sleep and bad quality sleep. So bruxism or teeth grinding also is an indication that we are having adenoids or obstruction while breathing. See, why is all this happening? Because there are just two entry points in the body, the mouth and the nose. Otherwise, it's a foolproof system. Nothing can enter. So the best defense mechanism is at these two places, the adenoids behind the nose and tonsils at the back of our throat. So they trap all the infections, they trap all the allergens. In the process, if it is repeated, they will become large in size and then the problems will start. Adenoids, when I'm in this sitting posture or standing posture, the gravity is keeping that space open. I'm not having any problem. But when I lie down, the gravity effect goes off. The adenoids will cause obstruction and the child to bypass that will open with his mouth open. Then, you know, there would be saliva tricking out in the morning. There would foul smell and all those things. And then in the night, he would feel dryness and then either get up to drink water or to go to the washroom. And we feel, arey, he's just getting up to drink water. Why should he be getting up to drink water? It's because of the dryness. So again, that is an indication of adenoids which needs treatment. Then again, this bruxism or grinding of the teeth, bad dreams, you know, nightmares, getting up in a scared manner because he's not breathing through the natural way. So all this dryness will cause this symptom of choking and, you know, somebody, so it comes as nightmares. So even leg trembling syndromes, all those things are basically part of upper airway obstruction. It needs evaluation. And nowadays, in today's times, we are hardly doing surgeries. We are all having good medications, and with a proper protocolized treatment, all these can be treated. No. Not at all. Calcium deficiency and even deworming, nothing. So these are growing pains. But what is growing pain? Growing pain is the child is growing and there is a deficiency of vitamin D and vitamin D related deficiency of calcium. Now blood calcium levels will be normal. See, my example is that, you know, my I may not have money in the bank, but my house will have money. So my bank also has to be full in times of distress. So when I'm unwell, then these leg pains will come in. So you have to do a vitamin D test and you have to treat it. It's all treatable. So you know that the child is tired and, you know, things like that, he's growing up. I always say that the children who are having a good growth, they're coming from good families, will have these problems because their rate of growth is not matching up to what they're eating. So they require to be treated.
Anybody else here, or we'll take the questions from the chat? I think boss has a question here. Mr. Singh? Sir, you wanted to ask something?
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
So there is good fever because your computer mic is on and your real mic is also. Anyway, quickly, I actually found this session to be very, very useful. So thank you for both of you, Shailaja, for you conducting it and for giving us such valuable information for our kids and for us. One good thing is, with the AQI that's happening in Delhi and on the path, please advise us that there are 3 points quickly for everybody to take them.
Okay, with the rising AQI, there are 2 or 3 trips that I would like to share. Avoid traveling outside of home during peak travel hours. You know, peak travel hours for Delhi becomes 5 to 7 or 8, and in the morning between 8 to 10. So in case you have to go to some place, you have to go to the mall or something with a child or even alone, we should be afraid of our health also. Avoid the peak traffic hours. Then secondly, always have the windows shut, even at red lights when you're stopping the car. Have the AC on, they have their filters so that the pollutants are not entering the car. Then the third thing is, tell your child that when he's traveling by the school bus, again the bus, the windows have to be closed. Nowadays many schools have got AC buses, but in case it isn't there, then please tell that the van windows of the van or the bus should be shut off so that the pollutants don't enter and be harmful. They could use the mask in case the AQI that day is very high. You could avoid sending the child to school when the AQI is high. And for yourself, please don't go for your morning walk, don't go for your jog if the AQI is high. So in today's time, please check the AQI and then step out of the house. You could have lot of indoor activities. The children should be encouraged to have lot of indoor activities, like they could play carom or they could have their friends come over. Let them play inside the house rather than playing outside, because that is the time the traffic is at its peak.
Yes, Athena.
A great huge round of applause to you, Surinder, Shailja, for putting this whole thing together. It's really, really well done and very, very informative as well, Dr. Dilwar. So just a little extension to what Surinder was saying. So what are the possible immunity boosters that you would recommend parents to give their children, especially during this time in Delhi NCR where we hear the AQI is high? From a diet perspective, you know, what is the preventative aspect? Let's say children who have just started going to school, perhaps they are 4 or 5, you can't really hold them back. But from a diet perspective, in terms of nurturing habits, what are some key things you could share with us? Thank you so much.
I would like to take that question by saying that, again, no medicines to be taken. Just give them a good diet, good sleep, and have a good exercise schedule. It doesn't mean they have to step out of the house. It could be inside the house, maybe skipping rope or playing indoor lawn tennis, table tennis, whatever. So have all these things in place. And something which I missed. Yeah, from the diet perspective. So this is a very favorite question. So we require iron, B complex, calcium, protein and calories. These are the 5 key ingredients. So whenever any parent tells me what should I supplement my child with, I will come down to these 5 key things. So one egg is equivalent to 1 capsule of B complex. So 1 egg per day. In case anybody is a vegetarian, then B complex is there in almost all the fruits and vegetables. You could have the fruits yourself and ask your child also to have a good intake of fruits and vegetables and salads. Have good amount of water. The second is calcium. So calcium is there in all milk and milk products. So they must have a bowl of curd twice a day. That is something very, very important and very, very healthy for the gut immunity. Then the third thing is iron. So again, I'm talking in retrograde, but you know, iron utensils, lohe ki kadai. So you could use that to cook the food, to boil the milk, so that the food is enriched naturally with iron, and the taste is not going to change. Only the color is going to change. So if everybody has it, your child will also not mind having it. So the iron intake goes up. Jaggery is an excellent source of iron. So you could, I come from Mumbai. So there we have something called as chikki. Here also we have patti, I think it is called. So jaggery and nuts. After they have had their lunch or dinner, you could ask them to take that. So jaggery intake is very, very good. Again, in Mumbai, we have puran poli and all those things. Jaggery powder, and then you make a roti out of it. So that's so healthy. So next is calories. Proteins, yeah. So proteins. So I always say that all these, things like rajma and chane and dals, they are very, very good sources of protein. Because of course, non-vegetarian food is good in protein, but I would like to address the vegetarian sources. So make the dal so thick that you can lift it up with a finger. So that half bowl, half katori of dal which the child is going to take is pure protein, rather than just a watery dal that he's going to take. Because his intake will remain half katori. It will not increase. And calories, banana is excellent. Nuts are a super source of calories as well as micronutrients. In nuts, almonds, walnuts are excellent. Pistachios, they are very, very good. And you could use raisins and khajur to have a natural sweetening effect in the food. You made kheer, you add raisins, you make a paste of raisins and anjeer and you know all these things. So that would be so healthy. So in case you could give all of this, it would be superb. And you're instilling these habits. Take it from me that after 12th standard, your children are most likely not going to be staying with you. So you're teaching them to survive in this big bad world alone and to take good care of themselves. So take this as an emergency. Take it as something which is very, very serious, because your time for achieving your goals will be there. I mean, you'd hardly be maybe 45 or 50 when they are gone. You have till 100 years to achieve whatever you wanted to achieve. But this time is for them. Balance it out, please. Otherwise, there would be just emptiness at the end of the day. That is what I feel. Maybe I'm wrong, but I feel we should give. If we are having a family, they deserve our time.
We just have one more question here. What is the maximum age for the adenoid surgery to be performed for a kid?
Okay. Now, you know, for adenoids, like I said, we never ever, unless it is grade 3, grade 4 adenoids, and the child is not gaining weight, he's not able to sleep, and he's not performing well at school, we don't refer to the ENT surgeons upfront. We manage with inhaled medications, in which inhaled steroids are the number one drugs of choice. Now, don't be afraid of the word steroids. They are magical drugs. They save lives. When we are losing a child, I mean, we are working in the pediatric ICU. When there is sepsis and we are losing a child, you give steroid and the child will just come back. They are magical. Possibly that is the reason they have been abused and used and used and used, and they have got a bad name. So when indicated, they have to be used. You go to the homeopaths and the other alternate medication, they are giving you the same thing, you know, flavored in other flavors, and then with side effects they will come to us, glaucoma ho gaya. Why should a child of 12 years, asthmatic of 12 years, have glaucoma and all? So please don't go to these alternate therapies. Face it, accept it and treat it. So 3 months, 2 to 3 months of inhaled steroids, and you'll see the benefits. The child will start sleeping, good quality sleep. He will start gaining weight, and in those who are obese because of the stress, they will start losing weight. The growth will come in its place. And in very, very, I mean, I may have in the past 13 years in Fortis, maybe 4 or 5 I would have referred to the ENT surgeon because I couldn't treat it. So it's surgery is not the option. And once they are into the adolescent age group, 8 and 9 years upwards, anyways, it is going to regress. Anyways, they would have served their purpose and they would have regressed. So don't be in a hurry to get the surgery done. I wouldn't recommend it.
Doc, we'll just take the last question here. I think it is very, very interesting. How can I support my child's emotional and mental well-being, especially in the times when they are facing challenges, disappointments, and dealing with tough situations at their end?
Yeah. Again, you know, even, you know, setbacks, even my children had their own setbacks, and my younger son, you know, he was appearing for NEET, and he had prepared a lot, and the results came in and the rank was 90,000. I mean, 90,000 is, I mean, it is too bad. And then he took a drop and he prepared again, and then, you know, he told me, Mama, the same thing will happen. I will give my exam, we'll come back home, the results will come in and we'll all be crying, and then the food will be ordered and then we'll quietly have our food. So please recognize that stress is there in the children. They are so scared, they are so tiny, you know. They may be very tall, but they are in their hearts, they are so tiny. They don't have the experience that we have. We have faced 20-30 years of independent life, we have faced, which we have not realized. We have grown in the process, we have matured in the process. So from the very beginning, of course, in the second attempt he cracked it and he's in Delhi Government College, but then use that in a positive way. Have a relationship of friendship with your child. Whatever he has suffered, whatever problem he has, you should have a relationship that he will come and confide in you. Likewise, you do the same. Many times I have had problems and I go and say, this has happened and that person is troubling me, I want to resign. So then the children will tell, come on, you can't let this come in your way and look at the long term goal. So have this, you confide your problems in them. I mean, not the big ones, the small ones. Ask for their advice. Then they will come up with their set of problems. You share your day's events with them and ask them to share their. This is right from the beginning. You can't wake up at 13 years and say, oh, I want to have good terms and good, friendship with my children. No, the time won't come back. Half an hour, 1 hour, that's it. You could just have your dinner and just say, just the two of us will go for a walk. Let's go for a walk. And that half an hour of walking, and you could just talk and talk out your problems. Because in today's time, stress and mental health have become very huge problems. And you'd be sitting and working here and you wouldn't know what all alternative pathways they might choose. So be on the lookout in the house also. Be on the look. I mean, now I'm going again, I'm scaring you people. Look at their hands for any IV marks and look at their sensorium. Don't give them money, please. Howsoever rich you are, please let them beg for even 100 rupees. Don't pamper. Loving is not spoiling your child. You can love your child and then be very strict. You know, only on a cheat day, on a Sunday, I'm going to be buying this. Otherwise, I will not be buying it. Let them earn it. You make them feel that they have earned it. You want to reward them. Let them, perform well in their project or their unit test. I mean, 20 mark question paper. And then you say, yes, I'm giving this to you. So that sense of achievement is instilled in them. And that thing that I don't want free. I don't want a free stuff. I want to earn it. Because I've deserved it. So instill that. Instill the pride. It's a good thing that I had forgotten to mention this point. Instill the pride in your child that he's proud to be part of your family. You are proud of him. I mean, he may not be a topper. He may not be having anything special about him. But he's born in your family. He's born to you. He's your child. So that is the biggest achievement that you have done and your child has done. Let him be proud of our country. Let him be proud of the culture. I mean, imagine in 70 years, we are going to become, we are the third leading power in the world. And at the end of 2047, we are going to be number two. Imagine that grit, that determination, that pride which people have had, that we are all surging ahead. So please let him be part of this happiness, this pride of belonging to this great country, this great culture, and instill all these good values in them. They will never let you down once they leave you and go. They'll never let you down in case you've done things at the right time.
So true, Doc. I would say keep motivating them, and the small wins, celebrate their small wins. It is never the end of the world, and there is life beyond failures. So this need to be inculcated in them.
Yeah, and the other thing is learn to say no. You don't have, loving your child doesn't mean that you have to agree to whatever he's asking. N-O. Even to a toddler, you know, they will have temper tantrums, they'll hold their breath holding spasms. You know, a 9-month-old child can bring the entire family to ransom. He just holds his breath, he knows that now I'll get whatever I want. So please learn to say no. Set their limits. You have to be back at this hour means you have to be back. You have to call up. There is no other way, otherwise I'll call up the principal. They may not be afraid of you, but they'll be scared of their teacher and their principal. That works in my case also. Otherwise, I'll give a call to your HOD. So then they're scared, and set limits. And loving them means bringing them up with strictness also. You don't have to say yes to everything. You don't have to spoil them to show your love.
Thank you, Doc. This was really, really an insightful session, and I think we've learned a lot from this. And for all the audience who've joined in, we've circulated a feedback form. It'll be a motivating factor for us also if you please fill that form, and we also know that how the session went for you. And then basis those feedback, of course, we'll keep organizing more sessions. And thank you so much, Mr. Singh and Athena, for motivating and pushing me to do all these sessions. And I think it was a great session for me too, a lot of learning. So thank you.
Yeah, and thank you. I truly enjoyed
this. Thank you, Doc, for your time today.
Yeah, I truly enjoyed myself. I hope it was useful.